Thank you so much. And thanks a lot for inviting me here, to you, to Marlene. So my paper is based on some ongoing research I'm doing on the changing meanings of atheism and being atheist in contemporary Kyrgyzstan, and in particular the younger generations of atheists who tend to distance themselves from their parents' generation's versions of atheism and draw more inspiration from new atheists such as Richard Dawkins and the international networks of new atheists of various kinds. And this interest in how ideas about atheism are changing has led me to social media, which are really important for many of these younger atheists as ways of getting in touch with like-minded people in the country and beyond. I'm not at all an expert on social media, and I'm not really doing research on social media in a systematic way, but I've become increasingly interested in exploring how this new generation of atheists see the role of social media for the efforts to craft atheist selves and form atheist communities, what kinds of communities they afford, and how they relate to how they present themselves and form communities offline. And what I find, and this is what I'm going to talk about today, is that while many young atheists, initially at least, tend to embrace social media as highly appreciated media for encounters with like-minded in a context where it's not really okay to be young and atheist, what they encounter there are very often images of atheists, atheism and being atheist, that they cannot identify with, and which they tend to see as irrelevant to the challenges of practical life where coexistence with religious others is a major concern for many. So this is what I wish to explore in this paper, this very ambiguous way of relating to social media and the opportunities they afford for being atheist in present-day Kyrgyzstan. So, the question of what it means to be atheist in Central Asia today has only received very scarce attention. There's a lot of studies that do include discussions of how like Soviet state atheism influenced the way people think about and talk about religion today, how it has influenced the whole institutional framework through which religion is administered in Central Asia. But what we don't really see is studies that focus on the life worlds of atheists themselves, those for whom atheism is not just a remnant of Soviet times, but a convincing intellectual, existential, ethical, political position. We don't have them, really, which reflects the fact that, of course, atheism has gone from having a very prominent position in the public life, or prominent presence in public life, to being virtually invisible in public space today. Most people who see themselves as atheists do not belong to any formal atheist organization, and most tend to live their identity as atheists in a very discreet manner. So the people I'm focusing on are relatively young, most are in their 20s or early 30s. It's a very diverse group who are attracted to atheism for very different reasons. So many experiences may lead a person to embrace atheism, and what people reject when they declare themselves as atheists are not necessarily the same things. For some, it's primarily ignorance, irrationality, and narrow-mindedness associated with religion. For some, it's misogyny, homophobia. For still others, it's unethical behavior in the name of religion, or caused by religion, or what they see as the unethical character of religious scriptures. It can be all sorts of things. But what most of them have in common is that they sort of distance themselves from their parents' way of being atheists and practices of atheism, which they see as a mere default position, which was held as adaptation to the political situation during the Soviet Union. And also for the older generation, it's relatively unproblematic to declare yourself an atheist. I mean, exactly, because it was seen not as a personal choice, but as a necessity to be one during Soviet times. But it's rather suspicious to be a young person and declare yourself an atheist openly. It's not merely seen as a rejection of religion, but much more broadly as a rejection of community and the values and practices that are seen as underpinning it. I'll just give you an example. Amir, who is an academic in his early 30s. He had come to Bishkek in 2012, but was born in the Fergana Valley in Uzbekistan into a family of Tatars. At 16, he left his hometown and went to the US, first as a high school exchange student and later to go to college. That was an experience that left lasting marks on him. He went to a Christian college and worked as a janitor in church, and was in this way exposed to Christianity, which, as he sees it in retrospect, made him question Islam as well as religion more broadly, and in particular the moral drives in religion. As he put it, "I had a passion for development work, but I couldn't understand why people do not do this really genuinely. Everybody is buying off a ticket to heaven somehow by doing good, and you see that in the Christian college too. You're not really doing it for somebody else, you're doing it mostly for yourself, either because you're terrified of the deity, you're scared of the almighty God, or you want to kind of write this higher spirit or whatever, show that you're good. So for me it's kind of unethical, and I firmly believe that we can do greater good without religion." So returning to the Fergana Valley in 2011, Amir then started seeing life there and the values people held in a different light, feeling resentful in particular about the way women were treated, the ways families were constructed, and the ways children were raised. But there was no way he thought that he could avoid following tradition there and participate in the events which underpin community life. Just how can you not do this? It would be really strange if you didn't do it. You would offend people, endangering your life, and so on. The machine is so much bigger than you. And it didn't really bother him that much, as he expressed it. "I'm going through these motions because this is part of our culture. It's almost like standing up and making your bed, like to go to somebody's funeral or somebody's festive event and say a prayer, or to follow somebody saying a prayer and doing the motion. It's just doing the motion." And now living in Bishkek, Amir also felt he didn't have the right to stand up against this, as it would create problems for his family. With their Tatar background, they were seen by many as Russians and had to make a special effort to be accepted as part of the community. Now they were relatively well integrated into the Mahalla, and Amir didn't want to put the hard-won position at risk. And then in 2012, Amir came to Bishkek to do an MA. And there he found himself in a very different environment again. As he described it, "I think Bishkek is very unique. There's this free spirit. It's such a city of contrast. From the wildest party to the most conservative taxi drivers, you can have it all within 20 minutes. His education and career had allowed him to live his life largely in the company of like-minded people, But he had also experienced how the city was gradually changing, becoming more conservative and religious, and becoming an environment where it was more and more difficult to be atheist, at least in public, as he put it. What do I observe in chaihanas, for example? People drink, people love to drink, but people drink out of teapots. They pour it into cups and drink it. Who are they lying to? They're only lying to the society because there's this panopticon, there's this invisible eye. We're all observed by everyone, and then people talk, and you're one of them, and so you behave in this way also. So when talking about the difficulties when one encounters when trying to lead an atheist life and be an atheist, many of my interlocutors, like Amir, refer to how public space in Bishkek is changing. So while most of them have more or less settled with the fact that you cannot avoid participation in a like, religious life in a family or in a community, where they would be really pragmatic here, this sense that Bishkek, like public space in Bishkek, in a city that was like seen as or had traditionally by many of them been seen as a safe haven, a secular haven, that this city was changing in this way, that it was increasingly difficult for them to be without religion in the city was much more disturbing. Some commented on more visible signs, like the growing number of mosques, for example, the various versions of the hijab that women are increasingly donning. Some focus on the less conspicuous changes, like a young man who recalled how, during the Ramadan month, walking around in his neighborhood, all of a sudden people were greeted with the he would be met by his neighbors who greeted him with like, may your fast be accepted, although he had never fasted. But the fact that people just assumed that he did fast was to him a sign that the city had changed profoundly during the last 10 years or so. Others were struck by increasing conservatism and intolerance, like Tatiana, who was originally from Turkmenistan and came to Bishkek like some 15 years ago. As she said, like when I first came, it was very different from Turkmenistan. People would freely hold hands, kiss on the streets. You never see that in Turkmenistan. I saw many transgender gay people. I went to gay clubs for the whole of my freshman year because it was kind of safe. No one would talk to you just because it is a gay club. No one is interested. And you bunch of girls could just dance. It was a nice place for us to go. But it was open. Everybody knew that it happened. Now it has closed. We have a gay club, but even I don't know where it is because it's only those in the community who know. They don't tell other people because they're really afraid. So in short, many of my interlocutors express our feelings of becoming strangers in their own world, of disorientation, of not being able to find a place to dwell, to feel at home in spaces they know, places they live and embody. A slow, gradual moral breakdown that call for a response and that atheists respond to in many ways. Many seeking out alternative spaces online. So, new media such as websites, blogs, online fora have played a big role worldwide in what may be termed a new atheist resurgence, creating new forms of interaction and communication between atheists, sometimes across national boundaries, and being particularly important in places where atheism is seen as controversial. And where atheists may feel isolated in the communities, like Kyrgyzstan, for example. for this younger generation of atheists in Kyrgyzstan, Facebook in particular is used as a medium for networking, discussions, and the sharing of information and experiences, as it's seen as more serious than other social media. So many are connected with Facebook groups for atheists and agnostics in Kyrgyzstan, others with more internationally oriented groups like Atheist Nation and groups for atheists in other countries, and especially Russia. So one such Facebook group was started up by a guy named Dastan back in 2014. It had grown since. This morning it included 2,230 members. So like with most other Facebook groups, some follow it more passively, as some who spend a lot of time engaging in discussions there, sharing it from information and experiences, everything from articles from the Kyrgyz as well as international media, religious satire, more personal experiences and questions regarding how to live a life as an atheist in Kyrgyzstan. Most posts focus on Islam, reflecting of course the dominant role of Islam as religion in the country and for the majority of group members. Some restrict themselves to participating in or passively following online discussions, whereas a core group of members also use the group as a platform for organizing meetups, discussions, talks, and so on. They also have like ongoing discussions about how to develop this Facebook group into what they see as a real movement or organization, something they thought would involve changing the name of the group, as the word atheism might scare off some people who would otherwise be interested, and put members at risk if they showed it on like t-shirts and car stickers and so on. And some of the people, some of my interlocutors really expressed an experience of relief when discovering a group like this, and the fact that there were actually like-minded people around. But others were much more ambiguous when it came to, when they reflected on what kinds of atheist communities were created online. So let's again return to Amir that I talked about before. As he put it, I was surprised to find this group when I moved to Kyrgyzstan. There's even a social network for atheists and agnostics there, and it cuts across different ages and ethnicities, of course. But what's interesting about this group is that some of the words, behaviors, that they incorporate is exactly what people resent in religions. So they also become kind of divisional, like us versus them. We have the truth, we know how things are, and so on. So you have this group which on the one hand is marginal, but on the other hand, it's also very selective, exclusive, and aggressive at times, and even evangelical in terms of the treatment of atheism. Amir was added to the Facebook group by some of his colleagues who thought that he should be in it, but he soon quit, finding most of the postings in the group too aggressive, to the point where they became similar to the religions they were bashing on, harassing religious people. Amir was not alone in this disillusion with atheists, online atheist communities. For many of my interlocutors, an initial relief to find a community of like-minded on the internet soon gave way to much more ambiguous feelings when they discovered that they were not necessarily that like-minded, that what they rejected when declaring themselves as atheists was not necessarily what other atheists rejected. Damira, for example, found her atheism intimately bound up with feminism, emphasizing how obvious it was that the Quran was written from a male point of view. But joining the group, as well as other social media groups for atheists, she realized that being atheist was not necessarily the same as being feminist or being tolerant to the views of others. She pointed out how many men in the group, for example, would repeatedly post pictures of women in burqas and make fun of the way they ate the food and so on, not realizing how sexist they were. Firuza, similarly, left the group after she increasingly felt that atheism, for those who discussed it there, was something entirely different from what atheism was for herself. Whereas for herself, atheism was connected with being feminist, leftist, and a queer activist, the group she thought was dominated by people who gave expression to Islamophobia, homophobia, and a rather rigid scientific worldview. She felt she didn't have the energy to take the discussions in the group, but also that she could not participate without doing anything, and thus she quit and found some other international online communities that better matched her own views. So, very often feeling at the margins of community, my atheist interlocutors were striving to find a place to dwell. Dwelling seen as some kind of balance between a sense of agency to be what you feel yourself are, what you feel yourself to be, a sense of agency on the one hand, autonomy on the one hand, and on the other hand, belonging to a larger community. It may be seen as fundamental for human existence as such. And for my atheists, interlocutors, it's a pressing concern. Whenever they step into the world of others, they tend to encounter behaviors, attitudes, and ideas they can't live with. In the face-to-face communities they, or the families lived in, and increasingly in public space, they found it hard to be atheists, experiencing social life there as machinery that simply required people to fit in. Social media seems to offer other hopes and possibilities for the experience of community. And for some, they indeed offered a safe haven where they could meet, engage in discussions with like-minded, kind of safety valve where they could share experiences that is seen as controversial in community, or just an assurance that they were not alone with their thoughts. Others were kind of disillusioned with what they saw as rather similar like ethical transgressions in online atheist communities that led them away from religion. The tone was perceived to be too harsh. They occasionally came close to the religious world they defined themselves in opposition to, in their intolerance towards other worldviews. They saw them as tools for dividing people, for igniting hate, as communities that did not really allow for the finely tuned ability to accommodate perceived to be important in everyday life. And as such, irrelevant to the challenges they met in practical life, where the coexistence with religious others was really important to many of them, as the case of Amir showed also. Many had family members, wives, husbands, children, parents, other relatives who were religious, and was also important for them to assure they didn't get into trouble or suffered due to their atheist convictions. I think in many ways, this friction experienced by atheists in Kyrgyzstan, in the encounters with the other atheists, I think it's an interesting mirror to religious developments in Central Asia in the aftermath of the breaking up of the USSR. Like this initial excitement about being allowed to explore Islam, to express Muslim identities and sentiments, has increasingly been replaced by a sense of friction between different ways of being Muslim, different ways of understanding Islam. A kind of schismogenesis, paradoxically driven by an existential drive to find a place of belonging and a moral community of like-minded. You see this among atheists as well. And this is something that perhaps become even more clear in the case of social media and the forms of communities they offer. this kind of perpetual creation of differences and senses of differences, and this endless search for a community of like-minded, which just, I mean, you see it everywhere, but it becomes just so obvious in the case of social media and the kinds of community they afford. I think I'll stop there. Thank you.